My name is Bob Baer. I used to be a CIA agent stationed in the Lebanon during the Civil War. It was chaos. But the real threat was always car bombs. And now we know you can kill a president, defeat a superpower, or just blow up your own government with a car bomb. All you need is roads, traffic. Every airport, any government building, or a street is a target. This is the film of how the century of the car turned into the century of the car bomb, and how a dream of freedom turned nightmare. Armstrong did not stop the Vietnam War, but his recipe for homemade explosives slipped across the Atlantic into the hands of the IRA. The world's first full-scale car bomb war was now ready to begin. And the material to make the bombs was lying around in every farmer's barn in Ireland. Every Easter Sunday, Irish Republicans march in Belfast to remember IRA men killed in Ireland's troubles. The troubles lasted for 3 decades and claimed nearly 4,000 lives. The IRA wanted to get the British out. Car bombs were the IRA's heavy weaponry, their artillery. Most of the time, the IRA called in warnings. The IRA's aim was economic terrorism. Buildings, not bodies. Under their own rules, killing civilians was wrong. But planting car bombs is not an exact science. And when the IRA messed up, people, lots of people, died.
What was the idea behind Bloody Friday?
Every now and again, the leadership of the Republican movement would decide to have a spectacular.
On the afternoon of the 21st of July, 1972, the IRA planted 22 car bombs in the center of Belfast, all timed to go off within minutes of each other.
Did you have any role on Bloody Friday?
No. I was responsible for making 4 devices. It was 3 roads and a bridge.
Bloody Friday was the world's first mass car bomb attack. The IRA phoned in warnings, but one bomb prematurely exploded in Oxford Street bus station, killing 6 passengers. Many others were horribly mutilated. Mina Wardle was just yards away.
I was actually just on the courthouse steps coming out when the bomb went off. And for some reason or other, just stuck to the wall at the side of the courthouse and could not move. I seen torso lying in the middle of the road. I actually thought it was something that fell off a meat lorry. There was signs going off. There was pandemonium everywhere.
Belfast City fell into chaos. There was nowhere safe to run.
We were being directed in all sorts. They didn't seem to know what was going on either, where the bombs were, exactly what was happening.
Are you ashamed of what happened on Bloody Friday?
Utterly. Very, very ashamed. It was a terrible, terrible day. There was no way that the security forces could have cleared because of the spread of bombs. Bombs were everywhere.
But the slaughter on Bloody Friday did not stop the IRA. The bombing campaign accelerated. In 1972, there were 1,382 explosions. The IRA leadership was now ready to bring the car bomb onto the streets of London.
We would bomb London. It was our job to go and pick the targets and plan the operation.
Yeah. On March the 8th, 1973, the IRA attacked London for the first time and planted four car bombs. 19-year-old Marion Price was leader of the bomb team.
We went to London, we picked various targets. We reported back to the leadership in Belfast. Then the bombs were made up here in Ireland, and we took the bombs to England on the ferries. Then on the morning that the bombs went off, the driver and the person who was to set the timer, they got up at 6 a.m, they drove the bombs to their targets. And it was planned that by the time the bombs would go off that afternoon at 3 o'clock, we would all be home in Ireland.
Marion chose four spectacular targets, including the Old Bailey Courthouse. But the most prestigious target was New Scotland Yard. Marion spent the next decade in prison. But over the next 25 years, the IRA would explode thousands of car bombs. Their Anvil bombs would get bigger and bigger. Just one bomb could destroy a small town or blast the heart of a key financial center like the City of London. Bomb disposal officer Mike Koldrick was called out to defuse the biggest IRA bomb of all.
Around about 10:27 on the Saturday morning, tremendous blast from the truck out there in Bishopsgate, about 3,500 kilograms, high explosive, sent a blast wave that ripped all the windows out of the whole area. Where we're standing now, you would have had an absolute shower of death, literally hundreds of tons of glass raining down in a few seconds. And of course the blast went through all these offices, devastating them, putting them beyond use for a considerable period of time.
It's a massive bomb, ring the police. Massive, I repeat, massive. You have the message.
When the bomb explodes, tell me what happens.
Well, the first thing you see is what they call in bomb disposal circles the big white light. That is an intense ball of high temperature gas. The shockwave comes away from the vehicle in a spherical pattern at supersonic velocity. That would take out all the windows in the area. The vehicle itself would have been fragmented, and those metal fragments turned into high-velocity bullets and would be lethal.
The IRA deliberately planted the Bishopsgate bomb on a Saturday morning, knowing that most of those city offices would be empty. It was economic terrorism.
The total bill to the insurance for Bishopsgate was around about £1 billion. Imagine 20 times that amount of devastation in city centres around the United Kingdom. It would have brought us to our knees.
How much did the bomb cost?
Well, I don't know how much a tonne of ammonium nitrate fertiliser is, but let's say it's £100. So there you've got about £300 for the explosive, £5 to £10 for the timing devices, and then you've got the vehicle itself.
Which was stolen.
It was stolen.
So we're talking maybe £400.
£400 or £500.
To counter the IRA, the British built the world's first electronic fortress around the City of London. The screening was supposed to deter the IRA. But unless you hand search every car, you can't stop car bombs. And the IRA always had the option of bombing another city. Manchester, in the north of England. The IRA never won their war in Ireland, but the British lost theirs on the streets of the City of London.
Did you think this was going to change the politics of Northern Ireland when this bomb went off?
Oh, no doubt about it. And I saw the devastation and realized how large those bombs were. I said, in 18 months, we'll be talking peace.
Ireland's troubles had dragged on for 24 years, a futile stalemate. But after Bishopsgate, the British government was suddenly a lot more receptive to a peace deal.
And how soon did it come?
Well, it took about another 2 years.
You tell me it cost £500 to change the policy of a major power.
Amazing, isn't it? It's a real bang for bucks, if you like.
Just 1 year after Bishopsgate, the IRA called a ceasefire, and serious negotiations to end the Troubles began. In the right place and with the right amount of explosives, car bombs really can change history. At the height of the Troubles, the IRA churned out car bombs, as if on a production line. But you don't need a secret army to launch a car bomb attack. Even the smallest terrorist cell can make a one-off fertilizer bomb. If you wanted to, you could plan to blow up the United States from your own front sitting room. In 1993, the same year as Bishopsgate, car bombers would return to America and strike again at New York's financial district.